The first is a save the date. In August, on August 8th, we are going to serve food after the service. And they tell me the executive team is going to pay for that. So that's pretty cool. So bring thousands of people. And let's have a bunch of people here and we'll all have food. More information about that. But right now we want you to know, circle on, don't go on vacation. Come here because we're having lunch after the service, okay? Secondly, I want to let you know that we at Entry Point, our perfectly imperfect faith community, we are not standing still. We are making plans for what is our next thing going to be? What is our next step? Where is our next permanent home going to be? And now we need to hear from you. So if you are interested in giving us your thoughts, please plan to remain after the service in 2 weeks. We are calling that our next step. And for it to be about a 30-minute meeting after the service so that, you know, we can find out what you're thinking, we can share what we're thinking. That is going to be led by Craig Trimble. And if you have questions, please see him. He is our treasurer. Craig, would you raise your hand so people can see that handsome young man back there in the black shirt? Is Craig. And so he is running that meeting in 2 weeks. So 2 weeks from today and then August 8th. Those are the things that we need to let you know about. Today we are talking about how to handle the notion that perfection is not attainable. We are not perfect. We all know that, but we don't live like we know that. That is so deep. Well, I know a guy who thinks that he is perfect. In fact, you know, he's a perfectionist. And, well, he walked into a bar. Apparently, the bar wasn't set high enough. But the only other joke I have is this one. So, you know, in all honesty, the closest we ever really get to perfection is when we fill out a job application. Yes. As always, we welcome each one of you in your perfectly imperfect life to this perfectly imperfect faith community.
That you broke, broken like me. Maybe that makes me a fool. I like that you're lonely, lonely like me. I could be lonely with you. I met you late night at a party. So trust funds, baby, Brooklyn Law. By the bathroom, you said, let's talk. But my confidence is wearing off. These are my people, these are my friends. She grabbed my face and that's what she said. I like that you're broken, broken like me. Maybe that makes me a fool. I like that you're lonely, lonely like me. I could be lonely with you.
Our shadow into a friend,
our fear into faith, our failures into teachers, our weaknesses into reasons to keep fighting. We can turn our pain into purpose, finding beauty in all of our imperfection. Thank you, God, for changing our hearts. How could you flub a note? You're a professional. And And he responded, no one is perfect. You're doing the best you can. We play our best and we hope for the best. Well, at age 15, with hopes of becoming the next greatest French horn player in the entire world, I didn't like hearing those words. Why was I even taking private lessons? Every single teacher in school had told me that if I worked hard, I could be anything I wanted to be. I was attending a high school with incredibly high standards and expectations. I didn't know how to move forward at that moment, learning that I would never be perfect. Now, I believe that inside of each one of us, no matter what our personality type is, lives an inner perfectionist. The inner perfectionist in each one of us believes what our teachers told us. If it isn't perfect, it's not worth doing. So we work out, we diet, we try to organize every square inch of our houses, we constantly search for the perfect food, the perfect house, the perfect job, the perfect spouse, the perfect weather, the perfect family. In her blog entitled The Inner Perfectionist, Nikki Michelle Sue recently posted this testimonial from a young woman who shares what her inner perfectionist is saying to her. The craziest thing that my inner perfectionist says is that I must have my world and my belongings perfect and well organized, so that when I die, no one will judge or criticize me for being imperfect or disorganized. I'm ruthlessly organizing my life in preparation for when I die. How cray-cray is that? We need to admit that throughout our lives, we receive mixed messages about whether or not perfection is desirable or even achievable. Like former basketball legend Wilt Chamberlain once stated, they say that nobody's perfect. Then they tell you practice makes perfect. I wish they'd make up their minds. I have a theory about why we strive for perfection, particularly in the Western world. I think it's because of the consumerism of our culture, that we walk around feeling less than, invisible, imperfect, and flawed. Here's why. We have a culture that loves money, right? It drives us so hard that we also have a humongous advertising industry that controls a lot of our emotions and our self-esteem. It is advertisers who, in their quest to sell us products, makes us need things. Advertisers create a need in us, the need to have it all, to have a perfect life, to be a perfect person, and then they offer us the solution to that need, products that fulfill those needs. Now, is that even reasonable? No. Is perfection attainable? Not in the least, but we walk around feeling empty. We follow the trends, we buy things, and we continue to fall short. We feel broken because we can't possibly keep up with the latest of everything, no matter how much money we have. It sounds crazy, but if we lived off the grid and we didn't even know what other people were wearing or eating or watching or what their families looked like or how well their kids were doing, supposedly, we wouldn't feel so misshapen and unacceptable. So how do we fix this? I think it takes an attitude shift. If we could remove the I gotta have it all advertising consumerism filter, we might be able to relate to some of the philosophy and lifestyle choices found in the Eastern countries. Let's look at something that is very common in Japan. When a dish is broken, it's not thrown away. It's repaired. And it is repaired in a manner which actually celebrates the break. This is an example of kintsugi, the Japanese practice of repairing broken pottery with gold, rather than rejoin ceramic pieces with a camouflaged adhesive. The kintsugi technique employs a special tree sap lacquer that is dusted with powdered gold, silver, or platinum. Once completed, the beautiful seams of gold glint in the obvious cracks of ceramic wares, giving a one-of-a-kind appearance to each repaired piece. This method ends up celebrating each artifact's unique history by emphasizing the fractures and the breaks instead of hiding them or disguising them. In fact, kintsugi often makes the repaired piece even look more beautiful than it did in its original manner, revitalizing it with a new look and giving it a second life. And while the art of kintsugi is beautiful to look at and appreciate, it is not a technique that you or I could actually do. But there is something else from the Japanese culture that we can actively embrace and incorporate into our lives, and it is called wabi-sabi. Wabi-sabi is the view or thought of finding beauty in every aspect of imperfection in nature. It's about the aesthetic of things in existence that are imperfect, impermanent, and incomplete. Deeply influenced by Buddhist thinking, wabi-sabi is a beautiful way to describe what is natural and pure, and to acknowledge the beauty of any substance or being in its most natural and raw form. So, when many of us stopped wearing makeup during the pandemic, we went wabi-sabi. Seriously, there's our Western culture creeping in to this Eastern thought. Our view of beauty relies on the application of products to our face and to our hair, instead of the opportunity to accept that our unmade-up faces with flaws and cracks and imperfections could actually be beautiful. Just get me some of that gold stuff and pour it into these laugh lines. And I'll be all kintsugi, wabi-sabi, like awesome. The concept of wabi-sabi might be better understood if we look at the meaning of the root words themselves. Wabi expresses the part of simplicity, impermanence, flaws, and imperfection. On the contrary, sabi displays and expresses the effect that time has on a substance or an object. So together, wabi-sabi embraces the aesthetic appreciation of aging, flaws, and the beauty of the effects of time and imperfections. They express simplicity in the truest form of an object. Finally, it embraces finding comfort in purity and a life detached from materialistic obsessions of the world. Now, there's a few places that we can easily infuse wabi-sabi into our lives, and not just the not wearing of makeup. The first place is in our relationships. A wabi-sabi relationship is one in which we deliberately accept each other where we are, imperfect, unfinished, and mortal. This is the essential wabi-sabi frame of mind. Appreciate the imperfections in others and ourselves. That's hard to do. That's really tough sometimes, because those imperfections in others make us crazy sometimes. But they're also what makes those people dear and unique to us. Besides, what would we do with a perfect friend or a perfect spouse? Author Guy Harrison has written, "Perfection is overrated, boring. It's the imperfections, the vulnerabilities, the weaknesses, the human elements that make us who we are, that make us real, beautiful, and necessary. Maybe we could all just stop trying to fix each other's imperfections and try to enjoy each other. Idealistic, I realize. Wabi-sabi principles suggest that our food should be natural, simple, and prepared from intuition. Making a meal should be a creative, joyful act, not a test that we can fail. Let's engage our senses more often when we cook and when we eat. Let's enjoy the dishes, the silverware, the cooking utensils, along with the smell and the taste and the texture and the sight of the food. In our homes, instead of immediately throwing away broken items, let's find the charm, the character, the things that are uniquely ours, even if they're a little bit broken. On the corner of every desk that I have had in every classroom and office has sat this dish of rocks, carefully crafted by my then 8-year-old, now 46-year-old son. When it was first presented to me, it was a completely round dish. Now you can see that the side of the bowl is missing across the front. That's because one day, many years ago, in my classroom, a student accidentally knocked it off the desk, and that side of it broke off. She was so sorry that she had broken the dish, and she cleaned up all the pieces, and then she said, I'll just throw this away. And I went, no, 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 don't do that. That dish is too dear to me. And now that it is broken, it's even more precious to me. So this three-sided, more unique than ever bowl sits on my desk in my own office. And when I look at it, I see a metaphor for that son and his imperfect journey. I find the beauty in his effort to make me a functional piece of pottery, and now more than ever, I find the beauty in the imperfection that it displays. I'm not suggesting that we all need to turn our homes upside down and infuse the spirit of wabi-sabi into everything we think and do, but I am suggesting that this philosophy could be a way to wrestle our inner perfectionist down to the ground and keep it there for a little bit. Our culture has long been too consumed with perfection. Perfect records, perfect grades, perfect looks, perfect everything. We are not perfect, and we need to find the magnificent in the simplistic and in the natural. Wabi-sabi reminds us all that we are transient beings on this planet. Our bodies, as well as the material world around us, are always aging and transforming. Through wabi-sabi, we learn to embrace the passage of time as a normal occurrence and a cycle of nature. When young children go for a walk, they pick up the coolest things: stones, feathers, pine cones. They are drawn to these treasures because they are unique in the world. They are miraculous treasures just the way they are. Let's abandon perfection. And let's start to see the fingerprints on the walls, the scars, and the laugh lines as perfectly imperfect. And oh, so beautiful, just the way we are. Amen. Good times, I'll keep the times. Betty Allison, who will be speaking about looking for signs. So don't forget to plan to stay after that service in 2 weeks. If you are interested in sharing your thoughts on what our next building might look like, and don't forget to save the day, August 8th, for the thousands that will come for the fish and the loaves that we will be sharing on that special meal together. You know, before we leave, I have to just say, I know you've watched Nancy Lurch over the last several weeks. So next time we're here, she's going to be playing drums and bass. And at the end of the service, she's going to juggle chainsaws. Have a great Sunday and go in peace. Amen.